We already posted the link for our meeting. And inshallah, anyone who would like to join our live class, you can just click on the link in the previous post. Barakallahu feekum. طيب بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Inshallah, we'll continue today our topic, which is about description of Salah. And last week we explained a lot when we discussed the hadith which known as al-musi fi salatihi, hadith al-musi fi salatihi. And today inshallah we'll go over other narrations which is related to the same subject inshallah ta'ala. Today we'll start with the other hadith, which is hadith number 281. It said, ومثلي في حديث رفاعة Ahmad and Ibn Hibban reported on the authority of Rifa'a a similar narration, which also says, and then come up again, that's mean from ruku' until repose in your standing, and repose in your standing. This is mentioned in other hadith. You know, the first hadith which we talk before, it said hatta tatma'in qa'iman, and the same thing was reported with another hadith. The following hadith, which next one, which was reported by Imam Ahmad, has in one of his narration, straighten your back until the bones in your spine return to their places. That means the spine must be upright. Now, all this hadith, in fact, talk about the same matter, which explaining how to perform ruku' in the right way. And as we mentioned last week, ruku' is, or bowing, is one of the arkan salah. That's mean one of the pillars of the salah. So it should be done on the right way. As you mentioned, or as we mentioned, all this hadith, all of them, they are confirming two points. The first one, that the ruku' or the position of the standing after the ruku', it should be completed in a perfect way. That's mean after the person, he rise from his bowing position, his ruku', he should stand upright in a perfect way, the full standing, not just stand a little bit and then jump and go for down for sujood. We said that this is wrong, this is not right. So after you make your ruku', bowing, and then when you rise up, you should stand completely and feel comfortable by posing for a few seconds. And this is why there's different narrations which emphasize this point. Some it said hatta tatma'inna qa'ima, till you upright completely in a perfect way. Other, which is mentioned by Al-Imam Ahmad, till every bones, That means when you stand from the bowing position, till you feel that every bones come back to its right place in your spine. That means you completely, there's no movement in the body. You already standing after you make this ruku. Now go to the next hadith, which said, or I'll just read that translation. An-Nasa'i wa Abu Dawud reported on the authority of Rifa'a, the prayer of any one of you is not perfect unless he performs ablution perfectly. As Allah glorified be he order him to do. I would like to emphasize about this point because we are going to discuss what does the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam meant when he said that you perform wudu ablution according to the command of Allah, to the order of Allah, because he said as Allah glorified be he order him to do. And this, as you know, the command of performing wudu is mentioned in the Quran. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu idha qumtum ila salati faghsilu wujuhakum, till the end of the verse. O you who believe, when you stand for prayer, that means when you are intend to perform your prayer, then wash your face. And then the verse in the Quran explain the order and the perfect way how to perform wudu. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in this hadith reminding us about this. And then he should utter the takbir, saying Allahu Akbar. That means this is the starting of the salah, saying Allahu Akbar. And praise Allah. Now look at this order. Perform wudu, say takbir, praise Allah the Exalted. And this narration also said, if you know some verses from the Quran, then recite them. That means after praising Allah, supplication of istiftah, the starting of the salah, then what you do, you recite whatever you know of the Quran. Say the takbir and the tahleel. Say takbir and the tahleel. That means if the person, he doesn't know anything of the Quran, like as we mentioned, a new Muslim, a new person who just embraced Islam and he is not memorizing anything of the Quran, what should he say? We are explaining this inshallah in detail. Let's go over this narration. Other narration relate to this and we are going to explain it in detail. وَلِي أَبِي دَوُودْ ثُمَّ اِقْرَأْ بِأُمِّ الْكِتَابِ وَبِمَا شَاءَ اللَّهِ. Now, there's something extra. In the narration of Abu Dawood, that means was reported by Imam Abu Dawood, then recite the mother of the book. The mother of the book. What is the mother of the book? The mother of the book is Al-Fatiha. Al-Fatiha, the opening chapter. And then, that means after you recite Al-Fatiha, and then as much as Allah makes it easy for you to read of the Quran. Now also here in this hadith, we got something more. That means not only recite Surah Al-Fatiha, but also after you finish Surah Al-Fatiha, you go ahead and read more of the Quran for whatever you know, or whatever you want to read or you want to recite. Ibn Hibban, another narration for Ibn Hibban, he said, then recite much as you wish. Much as you wish. That means you recite Al-Fatiha and then you recite much as you wish of the Quran. One verse, 10 verse, one surah, more than surah, it's up to you. But here I will explain inshallah all this in detail inshallah. Now let's go to the explanation of this narration which we mentioned here, because All these narrations are relate one to another in different way. So we learn from this that after you reciting, when you go to the Salah, you start by, in this hadith we mentioned later, we didn't mention Al-Qibla, but facing the Qibla is already mentioned in previous hadith. Therefore, the order is like this. To start your Salah, first of all, perform the wudu according to the way that is was mentioned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or by command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But before we come to this point, let's go back to the position of ruku', because this is the point that was emphasized in this hadith. Now, so we said that different narrations emphasize that the person, when he is praying, he should make sure that he pray in the right and the correct way. By what? By first of all, he should come with the conditions of Salah before he start the Salah. Conditions of the Salah. And we mentioned before many times, the conditions should be met before one start the Salah. And the conditions which was they mentioned in the hadith that we are discussing here, two. One of them performing wudu, the other one is facing the Qibla. But there are other conditions, inshallah, we'll talk about it when the time come and mentioned in other narration. So, in this hadith, which we are talking or discussing today, he didn't mention facing the Qibla. This hadith did not mention facing the Qibla, but this hadith, or the facing the Qibla, is so mentioned by previous hadith. This is why, my dear brothers, always we should be careful that when we want to make any understanding for any issue in Islam, either related to the ibadah, the action of ibadah, the acts of ibadah, or how to perform it, or by any rules related to any other subject or any issue in our life, we should not just take one single hadith or two of the narrations, the hadith that reported of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and then we make conclusion and we think this is the last form and the perfect way. We need to go and study all the narrations, all the hadith that was related to all these issues. And then we can conclude the general guideline and the right methodology. And this is why the ulama, may Allah Azza wa Jal forgive them and reward them for what they are doing, they make it very easy for us as a student of knowledge by collecting all this hadith, and then they try to classify it in different chapters, and then they come from this classification and they give us the summary or the conclusion how to write, or the right way to perform our ibadah according to whatever we learn from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So now let's go over this hadith one by one. The hadith of Rufa'a, which mentioned before, when he said, حتى تطمئن قائمة, till you rise after, till you stand up completely after rising from the bowing position. تطمئن, we mentioned before, that mean complete, perfect pose, no movement. And this was explained by the next hadith, which was mentioned or was reported by Imam Ahmad, when said, فَأَقِمْ صُلْبَكْ حَتَّى تَرْجِعَ الْعِظَامِ. Then stand up completely till all the bones return to its right place, which means the spine is standing, there's no movement, and there's all the bones is already now calmed down, pose, and you are completely standing. And then the next hadith, which was reported by An-Nasa'i wa Abi Dawud, which said, An-Nasa'i wa Abi Dawud said, إنها لا تتم صلاة أحدكم حتى يسبغ الوضوء. The salah of any of you will not be perfect till, first of all, he have the perfect wudu. And then said, كما أمره الله, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered them. And as we said, this is why the Muslim should make sure that he perform the wudu in the correct manner, the correct way, not just try to resemble and try to follow other people or imitate them without understanding. This is why he need to learn the order of performing the wudu. And then he said, the Prophet ﷺ said, come on, ثُمَّ يُكَبِّرُ اللَّهِ, saying Allahu Akbar وَيَحْمَدُهُ. Now let's discuss all this point as mentioned by or explained by Sheikh bin Uthaymeen. He said, لا تتموا ولم يقل لا تصحوا. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, لا تتموا صلاة أحدكم. That means the salah of one of you, it will not be complete or be perfect. He didn't say the salah of one of you, it will not be invalid. And there's difference between the two expressions. If I say it will not be perfect, that means it is accepted, but it's not completely perfect. But if you said لا تصحو, that means the whole salah, in fact, or the way that you do it is not perfect. Now, and then the Prophet sallallahu, you know, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he said حتى يسبغ الوضوء كما أمره الله, then he should perform wudu as Allah ordered him. Where did Allah order us? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered this in Surah Al-Ma'idah, when he said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا قُمْتُمْ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ فَاغْسِلُوا وُجُوهَكُمْ وَأَيْدِيَكُمْ إِلَى الْمَرَافِقِ وَامْسَحُوا بِرُؤُوسِكُمْ وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ إِلَى الْكَعْبَيْنِ. Oh, you who believe, when you stand for prayer, then you should wash your face and then your hands up to the elbow and then wipe over your head and then and your foot up to the ankle. This, in fact, the translation for the meaning of the ayah. So here the Sheikh mentioned very important point that we should follow the exact order as it was mentioned in this hadith, in this ayah. So the order is, and all of us, we know how to perform wudu. So this is what you call it, a tartib. Tartib, that means we cannot wash our face we cannot wash our hands, for example, before our face, or washing the foot before the face or the hand. This is the order. But also, something which is very important, there is difference between washing and wiping. Washing and wiping. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he mentioned in the ayah, he mentioned washing for the face and the hand, and mentioned wiping for the head and the foot. Subhanallah. So this general ayah were explained by the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, explained either by statements saying by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, or by actions the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam did in front of his sahaba, of his companions, who reported what he did to us. So we know that washing the face, the difference between washing and wiping. Washing, that means you take the water and use the water. Use taking the water itself and wash the face. But wiping, just wetting the hand and just go and wipe over the head. So it's not right to just wiping over the face or wiping over the hand. At the same time, it's not correct to go and take water and pour it over the head and wash the whole head. If somebody said, well, yeah, it is, you know, the ayah and the Prophet ﷺ said, wiping, just imsah. But washing is more clean, more bitter. We said this is ghulu. This is, in fact, extremes. Why? Because we should follow the exact instruction and teaching which was mentioned in the ayah and in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we wash the face, we wash the hand, and wiping over the head. Now the question some people ask, they said, yes, but the ayah mentioned also wiping over the foot, and we wash the foot. So why there is something which is confusing here? We say there is no confusing, because this was explained by the sunnah. How? Wiping, which is mentioned here in this ayah, as ulama said, referring to wiping over the socks, or over the khuf. So if the person having khuf, or having socks, wearing socks, then this ayah is applied. That means he wipe over it. But if there is no khuf, just bare foot, then he should wash it. And there's no contradiction this with the ayah. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained this in the way that he performed wudu, and also when mentioned with other hadith. So this is very important to understand, that we follow the instruction of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam completely. Now, also we learn from this hadith what the Sheikh said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam turned our attention, we as followers of Islam, we are followers of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he turned our attention to do or to apply the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We got this by the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the word which mentioned in the hadith. He said, "Kama amar Allah." That means perform wudu. "Kama amar Allah," as Allah azza wa jal order you. And this is a very important point, that the Muslim, whenever he do any ibadah, perform any ibadah, he should first of all do it for the sake of Allah. And this referring to the niyyah, the intention. And at the same point, also the second thing, that he do it exactly in a way that was described or commanded by Allah Azza wa Jal, or by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So when Allah Azza wa Jal said, فَغْسِلُوا وُجُوهَكُمْ, wash your face, then we should, when we wash our face, not be careful about this. Not just washing my face, I'm just putting water and cleaning the face. No. At the same minute that you are washing your face, you are recalling in your mind the command of Allah Azza wa Jal, that he commanded you to wash your face. And this will make your reward greater. Why? Because now you are doing what Allah commanded you to do. At the same time, you are doing it because he commanded you to do it. And you are recalling this while you are practicing this. At the same time also, another third point, that احتساب الأجر. What does it mean, احتساب الأجر? That means I am washing my face, three matters are involved. Washing the face, because God, Allah commanded me to do it, and I do it the right way that he taught me. Washing the face, I recalling that this is the command of Allah. So I'm responding to his command. Washing the face because I hope that Allah will reward me for what I'm doing, even if it is very little. Why? Because I am applying the command of Allah in my life and following his instruction. So three matters are involving in one action. So احتسب الأجر. What mean احتساب? احتساب, that mean I have the hope. I have hope. And this is why, like what the Prophet ﷺ said about fasting, when he said, من صام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا. Whoever fasts Ramadan, believing in Allah Azza wa Jal, and also in hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward him. The same thing when you are doing the wudu. The same thing when you are performing your salah. Whenever you do anything of the ibadat, or you are doing anything of the ta'at, obedience of Allah, or when you are avoiding whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded you not to do, always recall in your mind, in your heart, in your feeling, that you are doing this for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, following his command and hoping in his reward. Also, we learn from this hadith again the importance of takbir by saying Allahu Akbar. And we already mentioned last week that no other word can take the place of the word, the statement Allahu Akbar. So if somebody said Allahu Akbar, he add only one letter, Allahu Akbar, we said this is wrong. If you said this, you didn't start the salah. Why? What's the difference? It's only one letter. We said yes. But we said, Allah, that means you are asking. And the word, the exact word is Allahu Akbar. So we cannot say in any other word, God the greatest, or Akbar Allah in the opposite, or Allah A'zam, or praise to Allah. We cannot say any of these words. To start the salah, we should say the exact word Allahu Akbar. And he said, and then praise Allah. That means after you say Allahu Akbar and you start the salah, praise Allah. This new point was not mentioned in the hadith we explained last week. Here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam referring to what? To supplication that we are recommended to say after saying the takbir. That's mean between takbiratul ihram and reciting al-fatiha, this is the time between the takbir. And there is sometimes there is both. The sahaba, they used when they pray with behind the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he say Allahu Akbar, and then he pause, he keeps silent for a few seconds, and then he start the fatiha. And then when they asked him, he told them different supplication that we can say between the takbir and al-fatiha. One of them, subhanak allahumma wa bihamdik wa tabaraka ismuk wa ta'ala jadduk wa la ilaha ghayruk. Sometimes you can say allahumma ba'id bayni wa bayna khataya kama ba'adta bayna al-mashriq wal-maghrib, to the end. Another form قل إن صلاتي ونسكي ومحياي. There is different or several different دعاء استفتاح, different form of starting supplication that we can say after saying takbir. Now the question is, why there are more than one form? And this is very important, brothers, to understand. It is better for the Muslim always when he do the ibadah, he should do it and he is knowing what he is saying. So if the person he get used to say one single dua for istiftah, after he say Allahu Akbar, he just repeat it all the time and never say any or try to say other hadith or other narration, then it's like routine for him. So the minute he say Allahu Akbar, Subhanakallah, Alhamdulillah, Ashhadu an, and he say it, you know, in a mechanical way. I mean, it's like routine. Without, in fact, maybe even thinking what he is saying. But when you say Allahu Akbar, and this time, for example, Salat al-Dhuhr, you say one type of dua al-istiftah. And then in other Salah, you choose another one. Then that's mean you are making different from one Salah to other Salah, and this will help you to concentrate in your Salah. So this is one hadith. But the Sheikh said about Dua al-Siftah, we mentioned that this is what was reported by Muslim, and there is one hadith, in fact, Dua al-Siftah, which is more stronger than saying Subhanakallah wa bihamdik. This dua is Allahumma ba'id bayni wa bayna khatayai kama ba'adta bayna al-mashriq wal-maghrib. O Allah, distant between me and my sins as you be distance between the east and the west. And to the end of this hadith. Why? Because this hadith or this dua is more authentic because it was reported by the two Shaykh, Al-Imam Al-Bukhari and Al-Imam Muslim. So this dua which is agreed upon. And many people, they don't know this. They always just, they go to Allahumma for the one which is famous among people, Subhanakallah wa bihamdik. But the more authentic one is Allahumma ba'id bayni wa bayna khataya. And for the benefit of the brothers, inshallah, I will post all the dua of siftah in our WhatsApp group and also in the Facebook, so brothers and sisters, they can benefit and they can try different dua and try and memorize all of them, inshallah. Now the question is it okay to say more than one form of dua al-istiftah? That's mean I said subhanakallah wa hamdika, and then after I finish I say Allahumma ba'ad bayna wa bayna khataya. No, it's not right. You should choose only one. And then the hadith said, فَإِنْ كَانَ مَعَكَ قُرْآنٌ فَقْرَأ. That means if you know or memorize any of the Quran, then go ahead and recite of the Quran. And look at this word, اقرأ, and read. And when we say read, just to emphasize this, the meaning of reading, that when you recite or read Surah Al-Fatiha or any of the Quran, don't read it only on your mind without moving your lips and your tongue with the every letter, every alphabetic letter of the Fatiha or of the Quran when you are in Salah or even outside the Salah, to not be considered as reading or recitation unless you read it and say it and move your tongue and lips with it. Just looking or scanning with eyes is not right. So just to stand and say Allahu Akbar and keep like this and read with your mind, that's not right. And you didn't read the Quran because he said read. Naam. And they said وإن لم يكن معك قرآن فاحمد الله. And if you don't know any of the Quran, as we mentioned before, like a new Muslim or somebody who is not memorizing any of the Quran, the Prophet ﷺ said, فاحمد الله. That means praise Allah. Praise Allah. Saying what? By saying any supplication to praise Allah. Like Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah. This is as substitute for the verse of the Quran. Are they equal? No, they are not. For sure. It's not equal to say a verse of the Quran or to say just the word of supplication. But here, the person, in fact, is not learned and he doesn't know the verses that he can recite. Therefore, and because Allah Azza wa Jal make the deen Israel easy for us, the Prophet ﷺ advised us that he say any words of praising. And now the question is, can anybody recite the Quran with a translation? Some people, they said, okay, I memorize the Fatiha in English or in Urdu or any other language. We said, what you are memorizing is explanation for the meaning, and we cannot call it Quran. The Quran, my dear brothers, the Quran, only the Arabic text which is in the Mus'haf. This is called Quran. Translation never been Quran, but it is explanation, like tafsir, explanation for the meaning of the Quran. Can anybody stand up and instead, because he said, well, I don't memorize the Quran in Arabic, it is very difficult, but Alhamdulillah, I was able to memorize the translation in my language for the Fatiha. Can I recite it? We said, no, you can't. Why? Because it's not Quran. But if you don't know the verses exactly, then praise Allah by saying Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Wallahu Akbar. For this type, or this words of supplication or praising, if you don't know it in Arabic, like a new Muslim, can he say it in his language? Yes, he can. No problem. He can say it because it's not Quran. It is just a matter of dua. Na'am. And the narration which was mentioned by Ibn Hibban, ثُمَّ بِمَا شِئْتْ. That means after you finish reciting Al-Fatiha, Umm al-Quran, the mother of the book, Umm al-Kitab, then read whatever you want. That means you read more of the Quran. Like you said Al-Fatiha, and then you can read Qul huwa Allahu Ahad or any of the verses. And this, inshallah, will explain it more later on. Because when we read more of the Quran, when we just only recite Al-Fatiha. The question now, we know that reciting Al-Fatiha is a bulough. Now, is reciting more than Al-Fatiha is required or must? No, it's not. Which means that if a person in his salah recite only Al-Fatiha, his salah is perfect. I mean, is valid, and no problem with his salah. That means he did salah in the correct way because he recites Surah Al-Fatiha. But to add more of the verses, this is sunnah. So if the person he knows, then it is recommended to read. Why? The Prophet ﷺ said, ثُمَّ بِمَا شِئْتْ. Whatever you want of the verses of the Quran. Now, question maybe some people ask. Why the Prophet ﷺ said, when you stand for salah, then the first thing he mentioned, performing wudu. Why he didn't say, be sure that you make ghusl? Because here was not mentioned about ghusl. Ghusl or taking total bath only required when the person in the state of janaba. As long as he is not in the state of janaba, then all what he does need, only just performing wudu. And the Prophet ﷺ was teaching this man who entered the masjid and he prayed. So it's assumed that this person, for sure, he wasn't as any janaba. But it is already known for every Muslim that he cannot start the salah unless he perform full ghusl if he has a janaba. But here, the janaba or the ghusl was not mentioned because he's teaching and assuming that this person, he is not in need for the ghusl. And what mentioned, istiqbal al-qibla or performing or facing the qibla. Now, is facing the qibla must or not? There are two situations. Sometimes it is must. In fact, it is condition, precondition for the salah. And sometimes this waived for certain situation. For every Muslim, when he want to pray, first of all, he should face the qibla before he say Allahu Akbar. But there are some people who are excused, or there's certain situation which one is excused from facing the qibla. The first one, in the situation of the person, he cannot face the qibla. He's sick. He is in the bed, lying in the bed. He, for example, in a place where he tried to know the way of the qibla, but he couldn't. So in this case, we said then it's not must for him. Is it clear? So the first point is facing the qibla is must and it is one of the conditions of the salah. But if the person cannot face the qibla for any reason, because nobody show him the right way or the direction of the qibla, or because he is sick and nobody can move him to face the qibla, then it's okay. Why? Because Allah Azza wa Jalla said, فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. Fear Allah as much as you can. So the sick person in his bed, he may not be able to face the qibla. So it's okay. He can pray to the best of his ability. The third point regarding the qibla is that it is the person is able, the person know the direction of the qibla, but also he is allowed of not facing the qibla. How come? If he's able and know the qibla, why he's not facing the qibla? Where or when do we face any other direction in salah while we are able to face the qibla? This is during traveling and at the optional salah. So the person is traveling in airplane, in car, in train, in bus, or even in a camel, traveling, and he want to pray more prayer at night, long journey, and he said, let's invest my time by praying optional prayer, nawafil, as it is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam, whenever he travel at night, he do his night prayer while he's riding on his camel. In this situation, the person when he start the nafila and he is able to face the qibla at the beginning, like you are having your car or you are riding a camel, for example, and then you want to start the salah and you know the direction of the qibla, face the qibla, say Allahu Akbar, and then continue your journey traveling whenever or wherever the camel or the car or your ride go, even it's not in the direction of the qibla, and your salah is correct. This apply only in nafila, my dear brothers and sisters, be careful. This is only in nafila, on optional salah. But for obligatory salah, the person, he should stop, or even in his, whatever he is, he try to the best of his ability to face the Qibla. But in time of traveling and a journey and optional salah, you can pray and you can face any direction. Now, also, as we mentioned, that this first takbira is takbirat al-ihram, which is the takbirat, the pillar, and we call it, we explain why we call it takbirat al-ihram. One question many people they ask regarding how loud one can read when he pray. Some people they said, or some ulama they said, he should read or recite to the point that he himself hear his own voice. His own voice. This is one. Other, they said no, but it's a matter of reciting the every letters of the Quran by moving the tongue and the lips while you are reading. Which one is correct? Both is correct, but it is better and it is more recommended that you don't believe or feel that you should hear your voice, because some people they will get in waswas. So he tried to raise his voice so he can hear it clearly. But then what will happen when his voice during the salah is very loud? He may disturb people, other people who are praying with him, especially if he's in a masjid. He is praying and people are beside him, and he his voice is very loud. That's wrong. Therefore, we said the best understanding for this, it's not necessary that you hear what you read, but the important thing that you recite it by moving your lips and your tongue with every letter that you read. Now, also, when the Prophet ﷺ said, وَقْرَأْ مَا تَيَسَّرَ مَعَكَ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ, read whatever you think it is easy for you from the Quran. And the Sheikh, subhanAllah, he mentioned a very important point to show you. He said, look at this. The Prophet ﷺ said, تَيَسَّرَ, and this to emphasize the meaning or the concept of easiness in Islam. That's mean Allah Azza wa Jalla always, whenever He command us anything, He make it to the best of our ability. So this Sharia, this deen, is an easy to practice and easy to be followed. It's Allah Azza wa Jalla did not make it difficult. ما جعل الله عليكم في الدين من حرج. Allah did not make this religion as difficult for you. نعم. And this we learn also, he said, about standing after the ruku', and we explained this in detail in previous lesson. And also when you go to sujood, also the same thing, you should make sujood is perfect sujood till you have full sujood, which is atma'inan. That means every bones is posed, no movement in your body. And the same thing after you rise from your sujood. And here, maybe I will stop here to leave some time for questions. And also, I will ask a question at the end after listening to your question. So, if there are anybody who want to ask, please, you can ask Brother Al-Majid, and he will give you the chance to ask. Jazakum Allah khair.
I have two questions here.
Yes, will you raise your voice, brother?
Yeah, I have two questions here. You can hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Number one, takbiratul ihram, is it one of the sharp or rukun here?
Say it again, brother.
تكبيرة الإحرام
تكبيرة الإحرام
is it one one of the shart or rukun?
No, takbirat al-ihram is rukun. Because you already started the salah with takbirat al-ihram. So saying Allahu Akbar, that you start the salah. And this is the first rukun of the salah. It's not shart.
Then
the
question, Sheikh.
Yes.
If you miss one of the rukun, and you only that particular rakah will be invalid. So you will count from, for example, a person coming and joining without the takbirat al-ihram. When he saw the imam in ruku, he straight away went and joined in the ruku. That means he missed the takbirat al-ihram. So that rakah he will not count, and he will continue the second and finish it off. Is that salah valid?
Okay, that's a good question. Just to make sure that I understand your question, Brother Abdul Majid, you said that some people, they come late, and while the Imam in the bowing position, and they said only Allahu Akbar, and they go down with the Imam with one takbira. Is this your question?
Yes, that okay. Means he missed the takbirat al-ihram, he straight away to the ruku.
Okay, good. Now, takbirat al-ihram here is the one he said when he was standing, or even when he come and he want to catch the Imam, okay, and said Allahu Akbar, this takbira that he said will be considered takbirat al-ihram. طيب, now how about takbirat al-ruku'? That means saying Allahu Akbar to go to the ruku'. Now some ulama, they said here we have two action which is of the same nature. Of the same nature, takbirat al-ihram and takbirat al-ruku'. But for takbirat al-ihram, saying Allahu Akbar to start the salah, this is a bila. And takbirat al-ruku', this is must, which means is less. Therefore, some of them they said by saying takbirat al-ihram Allahu Akbar and going, this will be sufficient and will be considered as accepted for takbirat, to include takbirat al-ruku'. Is it clear?
Yes, yes.
Okay, this is sometimes, brothers, just to mention this, to explain this, sometimes there are certain ibadat of the same nature, when it's come together, it will be included. One of them, it will be included and the umbrella of the other one. Like when we say, for example, if you want to make ghusl of al-janaba, or ghusl for al-jum'ah, for those who said it is must, and then with the intention that you will make, I mean, include the wudu, then the ghusl by itself is enough, and then when you go out, you didn't need to perform wudu. Why? Because of the same two action of the same nature, and the major one is the ghusl, and it's include the ruku', the wudu. Same also for example, brothers, when with Hajj, with Umrah, like when we talk about Quran and Tamattu, because the person he do two types of ibadah in one action. So this is something, it's not rare, it is already known. I hope this is very, very clear for you.
My second question, Sheikh.
Yes.
When the third rakah or the first rakah, if it is one rakah is praying, the praying with the qunut, is it wajib or sunnah?
Salat.
The last rakah of the witr.
Yes.
Praying the qunut.
Yes. Dua al-qunut, you mean? Yes. Yeah, for dua al-qunut, it is not known that the Prophet ﷺ do it all the time. Therefore, some ulama, they said, it is recommended to be said once a while. That's mean you pray one night, you raise your hand and you make dua al-qunut. That's good, okay. But don't keep this doing this all the time and feel that it is part of salatul witr. It is not must. If somebody pray without making dua al-qunut and he make dua after he finishes salah, that's fine. No problem. So dua al-qunut is not must, and it's not rukun, and it's not wajib in salatul witr. It is sunnah, and therefore we advise that the Muslim do it sometime and leave it other time. Don't keep it all the time. Naam.
Jazakallah khair.
وإياك. Another question.
السلام عليكم يا نبي خان.
وعليكم السلام يا نبي، حياك الله.
Thank you for the class.
You're welcome brother.
Okay, question. The Friday prayer is led by a person, the imam of the Friday prayer.
Yes.
He goes to Dargah and then makes the Fatiha and all that shirk. No, he goes to Dargah.
No, I don't know
and,
what this
means. He makes Dargah means, you know, you have this some wali and they have this Dargah, they make Fatiha and all that stuff. So the person, the imam of the Friday prayer of Masjid, he is a follower of this Dargah practice.
Nah.
So the question is the Friday prayer, some Muslims who don't follow Dargah practice, Is this Friday prayer valid for these Muslims? Okay, now because it's a community masjid. Okay, now you cannot judge
a person, you know, unless knowing exactly his aqidah. Okay, so if it was known for the people of the masjid, I mean those who are owning the masjid, that this person is committing any types of shirk, be careful. There's difference between committing major sin and committing shirk. Committing shirk, that means the person is a mushrik. So this, and he know this, he know that this is shirk, but he practiced this after people advise him, then it's not right to pray behind him. But for me, I came to the masjid, I pray with behind somebody, I don't know what is his aqidah. I assume that he is in the right manhaj. And this, my dear brother, is very, very important. Always, always, the way of the Muslim, always have good assumption about other Muslim at first hand, unless he saw or he learned later anything which is confirmed, which is fact about this person. We should not just classify or judge people just by what we hear from others or by trying to explain or understanding what they do and we think it is shirk or bid'ah or something like this. First of all, the Muslim always have the good assumption. So regarding this imam, if I know for sure that he is not following the way of the Ahlul Sunnah al-Jama'ah, like a Shia or any of this group, then I should not go to this masjid or pray behind him. And if I came and found him praying, then I may not pray behind him. But if I don't know and I pray, and later on somebody told me that he's, then my prayer, inshallah, valid and it's okay. Now.
Okay. So if this is the only masjid, then they know he's for doing this bidah. So people have to pay 4 rakat Zohar namaz because there is no Friday prayer, right?
Yes. If the person, I mean, in a community, and but if in any community, my brothers, the Muslim are in any community, any masjid, they have masjid, they can pray Salatul Jum'ah. I mean, I don't realize exactly how the situation will be only one masjid in the community and led by this person, and most of the people around are of the Sunnah and Jama'ah. They should not, from the beginning, they get an imam who's not in the right way on the Sunnah. But in case, for example, you come to an area, like as we said, like a city or a place or a community where you are the only one in the way of the Sunnah and Jama'ah, and you are not going to pray in their masjid, then you pray at your home. And if you did not pray Jum'ah, for sure you pray for rak'at salat al-duhur. But if like some group of houses and they can have musalla for them, they can also pray Jum'ah because there are different issues or different views regarding how much or how many the numbers who can perform Jum'ah. Inshallah, we'll come, we'll discuss this when we talk about Salat al-Jum'ah, inshallah, in detail. Now. Okay, you have any question
just,
or yes?
I have. I just want to clarify Abdul Majid's first question.
Yes.
I want to understand better. As per my understanding of Abdul Majid's question, he said the person has missed the Takbirat al-Ihram. Since he has missed the Takbirat al-Ihram, he has to do the whole prayer, not the first rak'ah. This is my understanding. Is that correct or something different?
No, the brother Abdul Majid, he meant, as I understood, he meant that if the person, he came late for the Salah, that means he didn't catch the Takbirat al-Haram with the Imam. And then when he came, he found the Imam in the ruku' position. And he want to say Allahu Akbar. If he say Allahu Akbar with intention of Takbirat al-Haram, then he has it. Even in he was going in the ruku' position. But if the person, he start the Salah without saying Takbirat al-Haram with intention of Takbirat al-Haram, then it's right, as you said. His salah is not valid because he didn't start the salah. The salah we start with takbir al-ihram. Now, okay.
Thank you, Sheikh.
You're welcome. Okay. So can we just finish? Okay. Before I finish, just this question that I asked, I will ask again. What's the difference between at-tuma'nina والخشوع in Salah? We have two terms, طمأنينة and خشوع. And what's the difference between them? Who can answer this?
The طمأنينة is external, to do with the body.
Okay.
And خشوع, internal, to do with the heart and completely heart for concentrating and focusing on the Salah.
Okay, good. Also another different, that At-Tuma'anina is Rukun in the Salah. At-Tuma'anina is Rukun, pillar. Where we get this from? We get it from this Hadith. Why did the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam commanded this person to pray more than one time? Because he didn't have Tuma'anina. He didn't have Tuma'anina. That means he moved from one position to another very quickly. So this is why it is, the ulama said, At-Tumanina is Rukun. And the person, he can handle it. He can handle it. That means he can pose, you know, for a certain time till he feels that he is comfortable and in a full position. But for khushu', it is not must. You know, it's not Rukun. That means if the person pray, but, you know, he didn't have full khushu', is his salah valid? Yes. For how much? Depends on how much khushu' he has. So the person who have 10% khushu', 20%, 50%, this Allah Azza wa Jalla will count for him. Depends on the percentage of his khushu' and salah. But if he finished the salah, his salah is already khalas gone. It will be inshallah accepted, and at least he did what is was required from him. We will not ask him to repeat the salah because he didn't have khushu' in his heart. نعم طيب I think it's time to stop. جزاكم الله خير. See you inshallah next week. And if you have any a question related to this class or others, you can post it in the group. بارك الله فيكم. جزاكم الله خير. وآخر دعوان الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
جزاكم الله خير.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.